be here. Love coming to the Arboretum. I was just here for a meeting on Monday, and I'm going to be here this afternoon for the Horticulture Happy Hour, where we're going to be handing out worms. So lots of fun here at the Arboretum. So I have been down the road at NC State in the Bio and Ag Engineering Department for the past 23 years, since I was 10 years old. And so, but I'm a solid waste specialist, but I've been specializing in vermicomposting with no intention on my own. It was completely accidental. It was just this little fact sheet I put out in 1994 that exploded. I mean, just everybody wanted it, and it had to keep being reprinted. And now people in 106 countries have contacted me about vermicomposting. So it's mostly all I can do. So, and which is great because it's a lot of fun. I enjoy it. So, how many of you are already doing vermicomposting? A few hands.
Accidentally.
There you go. Okay. Well, and usually, actually, you're very representative of all of the groups I talk to. Usually, how many of you are doing composting? More hands go up. Okay. So that's how it always is. A lot of people doing composting. Yay! And not as many people doing vermicomposting until after this lecture, right? And then go home. Yeah, I want to get started. So vermicomposting is very different from composting. So you have to kind of erase what you know about composting and approach vermicomposting differently. Now with composting, hopefully your goal is to heat up your pile, get a nice hot pile. With vermicomposting, you don't want to do that because you're going to roast your little friends, the worms. So with vermicomposting, the emphasis is on using earthworms and their little secret partners, all the microorganisms. And there's actually a wider array of and more varieties and species of microorganisms involved with vermicomposting because you're keeping it at more of a steady state and lower temperature. So that's the mesophilic range, and you just have more microorganisms. So they work together to take a variety of organic materials and turn it into a super expensive, useful product. And I'm going to show you how to vermicompost first, and then we're going to get into the effects that vermicompost has on plants and how it helps plants grow bigger and it suppresses diseases and pests. And I'm going to show you how much it costs compared to compost, and your eyes are going to bug out. You will not believe it. So anyway, that's our definition of vermicomposting. Where is vermicomposting taking place? All over the place. As you know, all over the world, right? All those people have contacted me. But here in the United States, besides households, it's schools throughout the nation. And I have a curriculum on vermicomposting. Farms, community gardens, restaurants, grocery stores, a variety of businesses, prisons, hospitals, military bases, paper mills are doing it, and then at universities and colleges. So it's taking place all over the place. So the compost, and I just have that in there to show that it's not this. It's not what you know with composting. And I do get people asking, people who do not have bins that look like this. These bins are steaming. They may look like the bins in your backyard, but the difference may be that yours doesn't have heat coming out of it and steam in the morning. And so this is hot composting. He's doing it right. Some people who do not have steaming hot bins say, well, I heard that if I add worms to it, it'll speed up the composting. And that is not, no, you don't want to do that. I'm going to be teaching you how to do vermicomposting correctly. You'll see that it's a different environment from composting, okay? So you really don't want to combine the two. you may naturally attract earthworms that will show up in the bottom where it's nice and cool, and it's just because they know that the organic materials are there, and you know, it's like ringing the dinner bell for them. But otherwise, you don't want to intentionally introduce them to this. Instead, what you would want to do is invite me back to speak about backyard composting, and I'll tell you how to get a hot pile. So, but we're going to stick with vermicomposting. Another comparison here, that vermicomposting is faster than composting. The composting is going to take anywhere from 6 to 9 months, large scale, and small scale, it can take even longer. But even somebody who tries to say, oh, I've got this special contraption that will compost in 3 days, don't believe it, because it may decompose whatever goes into it in 3 days, but it does not compost it. You can't hurry nature, so you would still have to cure the compost for another few months. So anyway, like I said, mesophilic, whereas the composting is supposed to be thermophilic, and then no aeration, yay! That's the thing about your hot pile composting, you've got to aerate it somehow, right? And with vermicomposting, you don't. You set it up the way it is, and you let it stay the way it is. It's not a good thing to aerate it. So, all right, so earthworm basics. It's really important to understand just a few things about earthworms so we know what we're dealing with. And all of it, because what we're stepping into with vermicomposting is earthworm husbandry, okay? You're gonna be worm farmers now. Just like you were raising a cow, you don't just, you know, the cow is not about the cow pen. It's feeding the cow and keeping the cow warm, and it's husbandry, it's taking care of the cow. And so you're gonna take care of your little worm friends. And you're starting out with a problem because they are cold-blooded. What does that mean? They can't control their own temperature. So last weekend when it was 20 degrees, I was so worried about my worms. I have at least 25,000 worms, and I was just so worried about them because 20 degrees is not good. So they don't have the ability to shiver to warm up like we do, and they can't pant or sweat like we do to cool down. So you have to keep that in mind, that whatever the temperature is, whether it be really hot or really cold, they're fluctuating with it. They're hermaphrodites. What do I mean by that? Is it a boy or a girl? Or both, right? It means they're both. So they have what it takes to reproduce. Every single worm has that. Yet, it takes two to tangle, evidently, because we've never recorded, scientists have not recorded viable babies from self-reproduction. So, gotta have two to tangle. Okay, they don't have lungs, they breathe through their skin. Their skin has to stay moist or they won't be able to breathe. So that's really important. These are all really important things to remember about earthworms so that you can help keep them alive in your worm bin. And this is a big reason why we don't just dump them into a compost pile, because most people's compost piles are way too dry. And that's that other lecture that I would love to give you about compost piles. But anyway, so you gotta be careful about that. And then light causes paralysis within about 60 minutes. And so all the earthworms you see dead on the sidewalk outside, and people go, oh, it was raining, so maybe it flooded their burrows underneath the ground. And actually, earthworms can stay alive in water. If water has oxygen in it, they can stay alive for hours. So it's not like, you know, ooh, I'm drowning. That's not it. It's more like my skin needs to stay moist. It's moist out there. It's raining, it's moist. I'm going to go explore and see my friends. So they come out, and they're like, woo, this is so cool. And then all of a sudden, the rain stops, the sun comes out, and they're stuck. They're paralyzed. They can't go. And so, and then they dry out. So, sad story. We'll move on to something happier. Happy, big, huge worms. This is the other really important thing to know, that most of us think a worm is a worm is a worm, right? They're all alike. We all know they all live under the ground, right? They stay in the soil, and that's what a worm is. Wrong. There are over 9,000 species of worms. And they are anywhere from half an inch to 22 feet long. So, big differences. So it's really important that you get the right earthworm. This is probably not going to be happy in that worm bin sitting on the table there. Okay? So you want to make sure you get the right earthworm.
Do those come out and crawl on top of the ground?
They do, yes. And in fact, the 22-footer, they found it in South Africa, and it was straddling a two-lane road and hanging off on either end. So that's how they knew that it was 22 feet long. But yes, so, but this is really important. I made this slide with my very, very raw skills at drawing on slides. But anyway, this is important to know because remember we said what we know about earthworms, they all live underground, right? And then I said, no, that's not true. Okay, most of them do. So, out of the how many earthworm species?
9,000.
9,000. The anesics are large, the big fat night crawlers that we're most familiar with. They have vertical burrows that go under the ground. So they live in the soil, they eat the soil, and litter. What do I mean by that? McDonald's? Yeah, they eat McDonald's?
No.
They're probably pickier eaters, yeah. Kidding. Anyway, so they eat soil and, what do we mean by that?
Leaf
litter, okay? So that's what they're eating. But so far they're doing what we expect. They're eating the soil and living in the soil. Then we have the endogeics, and they have a different function, and they're in horizontal burrows. So this is sounding really cool for the soil, right? This is why Darwin considered earthworms, out of all the hundreds of species of animals that he studied, that earthworms are number one in his book, and it's because they did so many cool things under the soil, so and for the soil. So we have vertical burrows, we have horizontal burrows, soil, right? Live in the soil, eat the soil. Then we have this third group, and they are called the epigeic earthworms. Do you see anything about soil? No. They are shattering our misconceptions about earthworms. They do not live in under the soil. They don't eat the soil. They're living in litter, they're eating litter. Litter as in not only leaf litter, but manure. We're talking richly decomposing organic materials. So you'll see them in cow patties in the field. You'll see them in, you know, you kick under over a log and underneath it's moist and you've got bugs and worms and decomposing leaves, and that's where you're going to find them. Okay? So they are not living in, seeking out, or eating soil. Alright? Really important to understand that. Because some people, they think, okay, I'm gonna put earthworms in a bin. I gotta put soil in it, and it's like, no, don't do that, please. So, with one exception, and I will tell you about that a little bit later. Okay, so how many species of earthworms?
9,000.
Out of the 9,000, only 7 have been identified that are suitable for vermicomposting, and 3 of them are tropical. That cuts us out, doesn't it? So now we're down to four. Here in North Carolina, in North America, we've got four species that we can deal with. So you can't just go grabbing earthworms and putting them randomly in your worm bin. You got to make sure you've got one of these four species. And there's one species in particular that everybody uses. It's called Isenia fetida. I put it at the top of the list for a reason, because not only is that number one here in North America, but throughout the world. You know, again, people in 106 countries have contacted me, and pretty much everybody wants Isenia fetida, because it's able to adapt to a wider range of environmental conditions than most earthworms. So it has turned out to be the most suitable species for vermicomposting. So you see the common name up there, red wiggler. Why didn't I call it red wiggler? You're master gardeners. We know that scientific name is what we need to communicate so that everybody understands. Because, you know, I'm from another part of the country, and I might call it, well, in fact, so people in California, they call it California red, you know? And then when I go to South America, I hear people saying, oh, can I get some California reds? It's like, huh? So anyway, Isenia fetida. You want to stick with the scientific name. So there will be other organisms in the worm bin. Thank goodness they won't be this size. These are greatly magnified. In fact, the springtails up in the upper right there, you will not see anything that looks like that. What you'll see is pieces of popping salt, okay? In your bin, that's what they look like, popping salt. So I used to have a scorpion, but I guess I don't have that scary picture. But yeah, so you'll see these. But you're master gardeners. You're used to digging around in the dirt and seeing a bunch of insects, right? But they will show up in, you know, you may not see any, or you may see a bloom of whatever kind of organism, and then it will go away, and they don't harm the worms. It's not a big deal. So, okay, here, to further illustrate my lack of drawing skills, but I used to have a whole bunch of words for this, and I decided instead of having you know, just plod through all these words, what, in essence, I'm trying to tell you here about the vermicomposting process is you've got the worm with his teeny tiny mouth, no teeth, and so it's not going to go up and take a bite out of the proverbial apple, right? What it's going to do is just go like this and kind of pull things into its mouth, and the only things it's going to be able to pull into its teeny tiny mouth will be something the size of coffee grounds, you know? So something granular like that, and microorganisms, lots and lots of microorganisms. That's why in the first slide I said it's earthworms working together with microorganisms to break down the decomposing organic material. So, but I wanted to show you the kind of magnification process that goes on. That microorganism goes into the worm, has a very rudimentary digestive system, but in its gut, it has more microorganisms. So right inside, there's a bunch of microorganisms. So this one goes in to kind of join the party, and this whole kind of microbial explosion takes place, and what comes out the other end, in my cute drawing of worm poop, are lots of happy little microorganisms, okay? So, and this is to show you that the product, remember I mentioned at the beginning, I gave you a teaser about how valuable vermicompost is, and this is one reason. It is teeming with microorganisms.
So, Rhonda?
Yes?
So the microorganisms at Gwen aren't the same ones that come out.
Right. They're, well, the ones that go in may or may not come out the other end, but others will be coming out as well. So it's sort of a this magnification process where, you know, it just, and they'll be grinding up other food, and so it exposes more surfaces, and so there's just a whole lot of microbial action taking place inside the earthworm. And then it's just amazing what comes out the other end. And what comes out still has nutrition value in it that will keep microbes alive, and it's covered with this sticky substance. So it really has everything that the microbes need, and then to stay alive. And so what you need to do, you could store the vermicompost for a few years if you wanted to. You just have to make sure you're keeping your microbes alive. So they've got the food they need. You just have to provide adequate shelter, water, and air, and they'll be fine. So anyway, since we're talking about poop here, so what comes out of earthworms is called castings, okay? It's just a term, so we're not saying poop. But we call it, in the industry, we call it vermicompost, and that's to acknowledge that there are undigested pieces of other, whatever the feedstock is in the bin, there's undigested stuff too, and so we call it vermicompost. It's a mixture, which is good, by the way, because there are some people out there trying to sell their product as 100% castings, and it's like, really? Did you attach a bag to the end of every earthworm? Is that how you know you have 100% castings? You know, it's like not going to happen and doesn't need to happen, because there's really more of a variety of microorganisms in vermicompost, because it's not just the worm poop, it is the other organic materials. So it's really good. Okay, so babies, these are what cocoons look like, highly magnified, because that's a match head there. So it's about the size of a match head, it's lemon-shaped, and shiny and light brown. Anywhere from 2 to 7 babies will emerge, on average, 3. So just keep that in mind. There, as you know, the internet has all sorts of misinformation out there, and you'll see some people will say, oh, 20 babies come out of Eisenia fetida cocoons, but it's only on average 3. Okay, and we don't have time to go over this, but basically my point here is that they don't reproduce as quickly as people claim, you know, some unsavory people. So it does take a while for incubation to take place, and then when the baby comes out, it's the size of a thread, and it takes a while before it's sexually mature and can make more babies. And they do live about 4.5 to 5 years. But you won't know. In the worm bin, you won't. It's rare to see dead worms, because their little cannibalistic brothers and sisters will take care of that. So, anyway, you know, nature, that's the way things are, right? But, so, these are very important. These are the limiting factors. And so, again, it's a wider range for Eisenia fetida. They can tolerate temperatures that are very similar to what we enjoy. You know how it gets below 59 and we start shivering, it gets over 77, 80 and we start getting kind of hot. And so this is, depending on the climate, because I think humidity is a really big factor with earthworms. So in less humid areas, I think they thrive in higher temperatures better. But anyway, their limits are 32 to 95, and that's why before I started talking, some of you heard that I was really worried about my worms last weekend when it was 20 degrees. So my worms are outdoors. You may look at this and go, oh, well, I would have to keep the worms inside a even temperature place. And they would love you for it if you could do that. But all of my worms are outside, and so they have to deal with whatever temperature it is, and I just try to help them out. So, moisture, 80%. 80% moisture. That's pretty moist, isn't it? So it's not dripping, it's not 100% moisture, but it's very damp. And that's important because that's how they breathe. They need oxygen, but I've seen them in fairly low oxygen conditions, so you don't have to get carried away with the oxygen, especially because oxygen can work against moisture, right? Oxygen pulls moisture out through evaporation. So you want to be careful about how you aerate and how much aeration you provide for the worms. pH, they tolerate a very wide range of pH, as you can see. They prefer 7, but they can live in these conditions. But acidic conditions can throw off the pH of the worm bin and make things not right. So it's best if you can aim for 7. They are sensitive, however, to ammonia and salt. So keep that in mind. So ammonia, that would rule out what type of manure?
Chicken.
Yep. So straight chicken manure, no. Don't feed it to earthworms. Salt, what could be high in salt? Anybody think of anything high in salt?
Fertilizers.
Yeah, we're not going to feed that to worms. Good point, but yeah. So keep fertilizer out. But also, sometimes we get a little heavy with the salt shaker, right? Especially, I mentioned it's in prisons. Sometimes, I think a lot of prisons and hospitals are trying to clean up their act in schools and have healthier diets, but it used to be, a lot of salt in their diets. Also, hog manure can be high in salt. Now, I've seen raw hog manure fed to worms, and it was no problem. But just to let you know, just keep in mind that those are limiting factors, ammonia and salt. So, but wide range of things that can be fed to earthworms. This is just part of the list. But basically, your kitchen scraps and plate scrapings and, stuff in your yard, coffee grounds, animal manures, except for chicken, poultry, crop residues on farms, yard trimmings, scrap paper, and organic byproducts from industries, So a wide variety of things. So let me get on my soapbox for a minute here, because there is no reason why we should be throwing away food waste. It's dumb. It's stupid. Most of us hopefully nowadays are not tossing aluminum cans away. We've learned to keep our cans, papers, bottles out of the landfill. And yet, people are still throwing away food waste. They put it in their garbage or they put it down their sink. Because it's easy, right? It seems easy. Well, there is no easy. We all live on this planet and everything has consequences. And the consequence, if you put it in your garbage, is not only will your garbage get stinky, but when it goes to the landfill, then it turns into methane. It releases methane gases, which is a potent greenhouse gas. And everybody's talking about how crazy our weather is nowadays, with climate change. And so one of the biggest causes is from landfills. Most people think it's cars and cows, but it's landfills. Landfills are number 3 of human-generated activities that cause methane. So not a good idea to put it in landfills. It also makes landfills more toxic by having the food waste in there. That's a whole other lecture. But anyway, if you put it down your drain, where does it go? Into your septic tank. And then your septic tank costs you more money because you have to keep having it pumped out more often. And it messes up the biology of the septic tank. Otherwise, if you live in a small community, it might go straight into a stream and kill the aquatic life. Or if you live in Raleigh, it may go to the fancy wastewater treatment plant, one of the best in the world. They tried to get these things banned. Any of you remember that?
Yes.
Yeah, They don't want it. They don't want it because it throws off the biology of this fancy, one of, you know, humankind's best creations for managing wastewater. And they're like, we don't want it. We don't want that food waste because it totally messes things up. So it's just not a good idea. And it's so easy. Right now, you know, instead of throwing everything in the garbage, we have a separate place where we put our cans, paper bottles. Why not do that with our food waste? It's so easy to do. And then your garbage won't stink. You know, my little bag of garbage goes out, it's at least a week before my garbage has to go outside. If I was putting food waste in there, it would stink to high heaven, and I would want to take it out sooner. So it just makes everything so much easier. So anyway, and just to back that up, this is food waste discard, or I'm sorry, these are the categories of waste that are going to landfills. So this is not generation rates, because if it was generation rates, what is the largest category of waste that we generate? No, it's not.
Paper.
Yes. He said paper. This is the number one thing that we come across with and eventually discard, right? I mean, we've got paper all over the place. But paper is number three going into landfills. Why is that? When the majority of what we...
Recycling.
It's because of recycling. Yeah. So... because of recycling, food waste, which is so much smaller in what we generate, food waste is number one going to the landfills. And it's only because throughout this country, we don't have the infrastructure in place to collect food waste. Many cities are picking up food waste curbside. So it's going to happen. It's starting to happen, and it's in over 120 cities. But, and here in, and other innovative things are coming up where people will pick up your food waste. So here in Raleigh, we have Compost Now. Anybody heard of Compost Now? They'll come to your house and pick up your food waste, and they make sure it gets composted, and then they'll bring you compost back. So no excuses to not keep your food waste out of landfills. But it's even easier and cheaper if you just feed the food waste to worms or put it in your backyard composting bin. So, to vermicompost, these are the things we need, okay? So I'm gonna go through all of these. And they're in the handout. This handout was designed actually for the state fair when we had a big vermicomposting display at the state fair about 4 years ago. And so this is a nice double-sided, you know, it's just a nice summary of how to set up a worm bin. When you go home and you're thinking about setting up your worm bin, I want you to go on the URL, the website that's listed on the back. It says worms.ncsu.edu, and you'll find a publication called Worms Can Recycle Your Garbage, and that's about 5.5 pages, and that tells you more in detail how to set it up. But many of you are master gardeners. This is a great just two-sided, printed on both sides of one piece of paper, and you can have this to hand out at events. So you want to start out with a plastic or a wooden worm bin, okay? That's what most people do. This shows manufactured worm bins. I have over 12 types of worm bins. This shows just, I guess, 6 of them. I have a compost training facility that's just south of the university. It's a 2-acre facility. It's at NC State's Lakeway Wheeler Field Labs. And so I have over a dozen worm bins, from small to really, really large, like a 40 square foot worm bin. And then I have about a dozen types of backyard composting bins, too, just so you can see the different products that are out there. But anyhow, so you start out with a bin where you can buy, those were all manufactured bins, but they range in price from oh, these mono bins over here, that's probably $30-$35 for each of those. This one is a stacking bin. That's a stacking bin. They go for $99 to $120. They're great, but you know, when you're starting out, you might want to start out with something cheaper. Just make your own bin. And so that's why I brought this, and hopefully you're going to be able to see this with the light. But anyhow, this is just a, can everybody see this? Okay. And it, am I blocking anybody's way? Okay. So this is, you know, I just went to like a big box store and it cost $5. So it's a container. It can be anywhere from a 10 gallon to 14 gallon. This is a 10 gallon. Okay? Perfect size to start out with. I make sure it has a lid that actually closes, because some of these things, the lid kind of sits on top. This one, listen quietly, carefully. See? That was it clicking shut. This is me lifting the bin only by the lid. Okay? So this is as secure as it gets. And then in my slide, you can see that you would need air for your worms, right? And this is an airtight container. And so you want to put air holes around the top sides of the bin. That's it. Top sides means up here, right? That's the only place where you're going to put air holes. So in all of my publications, I give you three options. You can either have a lot of really tiny holes, again, just in the top, just with your drill, right? Little tiny holes. Or this was my very first bin. I had big babies, you know? They were like half inch holes. And I put those, you know, like a few on each side, all the way around top. I left them open. If I were more Martha Stewart-ish, I would get out my glue gun, which I don't have, and hardware cloth, and cover the holes, you know? But I had them open, had them under my desk at work, and, you know, they were fine. So, or now my favorite thing to do is use a hole saw, okay? So it's like a drill on steroids. And you can either put a 2-inch hole or a 3-inch hole in just one of the narrow sides of the bin, okay? So you don't have to have all those other little holes. So you're just doing two holes. So it's like that. And then you can get this handy dandy soffit bin. So soffit bins come as either 2 inches or 3 inches. And these you would find in the gutter section of a hardware store. And they're, you know, for your soffits on your roof. And it's got little louvers here. And just take it and boop, pop it in. Pretty cool, huh? So now you've closed your holes and you can rest more easily.
What are you keeping out or keeping in?
You're trying to keep the worms in because they get a little wanderlust once in a while, you know? And so the way this is with the louvers, if they really were desperate to get out, they could suck it in and get out of these. It's very, you know, but they're really, they have to really suck in their gut to get out of there. And then, you know, it discourages other things from getting in. Now, is it going to stop fruit flies? No. But hopefully you're going to manage your bin and not have fruit flies. And I'm going to knock on wood, but I've never had fruit flies. And I've had worm bins for, you know, 2 dozen years. Okay? So I'm going to tell you the secret of not getting fruit flies. Okay? That's why I'm here. That's part of my job, right? I'm not going to sell anything to you that's yucky, slimy, everything's going to be a mess. In fact, I'm going to tell you, I just lost my thing here. Ta-da! I covered it up. I'm going to show you where you can keep your worm bin, and you'll be amazed. But anyway, so air, upper side of the bin, drainage. If you're doing things right, you should not have liquid leaking out of your bins, okay? I don't have liquid leaking out of my bins, but most people do, and don't beat yourself up. So it's good to put some holes on the bottom of the bin, just where the liquid can drip out. This has many more holes than you need. If you look at my slide, it says 6 holes. This has a lot more than that. It's only because I set this up to be a double decker, okay? So you can set it up so you have 2 bins, and then you want more holes so the worms can move through them. So holes, sides, bottom, that's it. Not on the lid, okay? And you'll buy commercial worm bins that have holes in the lid. It's like, why? Because you're gonna let in light, which they don't like, and you're gonna, if it's outside, you're gonna let in rain, or you're gonna have evaporation coming up when you're trying to keep it 80% moisture. So don't do anything with lid, just leave it like that. It's best if you can have a dark color just to, you know, keep the light out of it. All right? So, where to put the worm bin? See, told you, there's my worm bin. In my office, under my desk, used to be, not anymore. Now I keep them all at the worm barn, south of NC State. But this was my worm bin, okay? And but at home, people like to put it in their garage or carport, back porch, deck, kitchen, basement, apartment, balcony. So, you know, if you live in an apartment and they won't let you have a compost bin, you can have a worm bin that you either keep inside or outside. If you keep it outside, never put it in the direct sunlight. It's got to be in a shaded area. Living room, bathroom. I'm not kidding about the living room. I had some friends, lovely coffee table. Their friends wouldn't know it was a worm bin until they decided to show it off. I had other friends in their kitchen, lovely chopping block table. Chop, 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 move it aside, put the food scraps right in the worms waiting below. Yes, feed me. So I'm gonna show you a couple other things. Master Gardener in Durham. This is 2 photos, okay? I just wanted to show you her Martha Stewart laundry room. So she's got this counter where she gets to fold her clothes, and she has this lovely curtain. You open up the curtain, and there's the worm bin that she has on rollers, and everything matches because she's matchy-matchy Martha Stewart, you know? But she's got the green bin, the little spritzer bottle that you need, and of course hers is matching green. But it all goes under there. The people who live with her don't know it's there. So, there's a class in Ohio, at Ohio State University, and these 2 professors, like an art professor and a design professor, got together to teach a class called Worms in My Furniture. And the students were, they had to create worm bins that were also furniture. And then they had me fly up and critique their projects. But the art teacher, this was a wonderful planter she had in her office. This is me sitting in the rocking chair. And as you rock, it spritzes water onto the plant. So this contains worms in all of those containers. And this is a beautiful table that they created. The table, it has a built-in iPad, and this is the lid, the lovely lid that to the worm bin. So this is the worm bin. So lots of ideas for worm bins. So it's not this yucky thing, you know? But so you've got your bin, and you need bedding for your bin, right? Because this is dry, and I said the worms need a wet environment. So what a lot of people do is use newspapers in their bin, okay? So a lot of people will use office paper that they run through a shredder, or they use newspaper that they shred themselves. And kids love it, you know? You hand it to kids and say, okay, have a little shredding party. And see, you can just shred it up just like that. Now, did I measure and get out my scissors? No, because who wants to do that? That is no fun. No, what I did is, and I had to look at the, I looked at what newspaper I had, because if I had the News and Observer, the Raleigh paper, then I would hold it up as if I were going to read it, and then I would start shredding. But this is the Indy. The Indy is a little sideways paper, and you literally have to hold it sideways to get, seriously, to get the knife. And it's only because of the way it was manufactured. It has nothing to do with who it is. But anyway, so we've got our shreds here, and we want to moisten the shreds, right? So these are the choices for bedding that you can use, but you have to moisten it. And so I've got some water here, and I'm gonna dunk the paper in. And you can see it's dripping, right? The paper's wet, right? Well, only the very outer fibers of the paper are wet. If I set this down and we came back this afternoon, the paper would be completely dry. And it's because we really need to let it soak. That's why I said, let it soak about 10 minutes. So it really absorbs the water into all of its fibers. And then we're gonna squeeze it out, just wring it out like a sponge. But then you got this ball, right? You got a hard ball, and so you want to pull that apart a little bit, and you toss it in the bin. So that's what you're going to do. And you're not going to have a little container like this. You're going to have a bucket, okay? So you got a bucket, you got your little paper shredding party, or your office shredder, and then you dunk it in the bucket, let it sit for about 5-10 minutes, and then squeeze it out and put it in the bin. Okay, so very simple. Add more as it disappears. Where is it going to disappear to? Louder? They'll eat it, right? Yeah, because it's organic, right? So they'll be eating it. Not overnight. In fact, it's going to be a few months. So don't think, oh my gosh, you know, every day I'm going to have to shred paper. No, no way. It's going to be a few months from now before you'll notice that the paper is slowly disappearing, and then finally you need to add more bedding. So, and then if it gets dry, maybe the top of it would get dry just from looking inside all the time, some evaporation takes place, you would use a plant mister like this, and you would just spritz it. Okay? No pouring, only spritzing. Never ever pour water into a worm bin, even if you've seen them do it on the internet. Okay, this is the one exception. Remember, the worms are not there for soil, okay? They're not living in it, they're not looking for it. It's helpful if you put a handful, just a handful, because you'll be adding over a trillion microbes to the worm bin. It doesn't need it. It already, you know, the paper, whatever bedding you put in there is already covered with microbes. The worms are, the food you put in, everything has microbes. But this is like a little inoculant to jumpstart it. And it does help the worms to digest better. It helps push the food through. So it's handy, but just a handful. So, with Isenia fetida, you want to start with a pound, okay? In a pound is about 1,000, roughly 1,000. So when you order your worms, you're going to eyeball them. You're not going to count 1,000 worms. If you do, call me, and because most people are not going to do that. But eyeball them and just make sure that you think you got about 1,000 worms, okay? If they're all really large, which hopefully they're not, you'd have more like 500. You actually want a mixture of big and small worms. Okay, you need about 1 pound of worms to 1 square foot of surface area per day. This is like if you wanted to get into production. If you're just gonna do a household bin, just go with 1 pound of worms, you're set, okay? But if any of you have farms or you wanna do a larger scale thing, you would want 1 pound per square foot of surface area. We're not talking cubic feet. We don't care about anything below the surface because worms are surface feeders. They go up to eat. So we're not talking about this, all right? So, despite what you'll see on the internet about their consumption habits, they really only consume about 1/4 to 1/3 of their body weight per day. You'll see on the internet at least 50 to 100%, but it's more likely 1/4. And it's not like you're measuring, but just to keep your expectations, okay? Don't get from your yard or bait shop. Why am I saying that? Pardon?
It's the wrong species.
Right? Yeah, what do you know about the species you're getting from your yard, right? You don't know. So you don't want to just take random species and put them in here. Because like I said, how many have been identified that are suitable for vermicomposting?
Four.
Yep, 4 in North America. Okay, so, and if you got them from your bait shop, in a bait cup, you're gonna have 12 to 30 worms. That's it. You need 1,000. So you would have to buy like 33 to 40 of those styrofoam bait cups. And that would not be cool. It wouldn't be cost effective. And then we get into that landfill issue, right? We don't want to even go there, okay? So you need to get it from a worm grower. Their prices vary widely, anywhere from $22 to $50 per pound. So you probably want to look around a little bit. Okay.
So you're going to spend $50 on that little tiny box?
Yes, of 1,000 worms, yep. That's why I never would. I would buy the cheaper ones. But, you know, the guy who's selling them for $49.99, his site usually pops up first when you Google worms on the internet. So
it's still $22 for a box that size?
What do you mean a box that size?
Your blue box
there. Oh, right, that you would put in here? Yes, yes. And that's why, instead of me just getting up here and, you know, for 10 minutes, just say, yeah, have a worm bin. Oh, this is easy to do. That's why I'm taking the time to walk you through it and make sure you do things right. Because you don't want to, because, you know, for me, I've invested a whopping $7 into this. $5 for the bin, $1 each for the soffit bin. And so then the worms are going to cost $22, $25. And so I want to keep my worms alive. And then they'll reproduce, and then you'll have $50 worth in here, you know? So at some point, you'll have too many worms in here, and you'll want to divide them up, and then you could sell them to somebody else or donate them to someone. But yeah, that's going to be your investment, is the worms cost money. Yeah. So speaking up, here they are. When you get your worms, they'll come in a bag or a box or both. So these are the worms that I caught locally, and they were in kind of a big Chinese box, you know, take-home box, and then like a breathable bag. And so all you do, inside the bag you have the worms and then some type of bedding material that keeps them alive. And you'll have some castings in there too. You very gently just open the bag and just kind of gently shake it out on the top of the bin. And that's it. You don't do anything more with it. You may think you would be helping the worms to put them underneath, but they're going to move away from the light. So if you help them, you might accidentally hurt their bodies because they're fragile. So you just gently put it like that. I even just leave the bag in there because you'll always have some worms that are stuck inside the bag. The bag is dry, so they'll move out of the bag into the nice moist bedding. So you can remove the bag after a couple of days. Yes?
Oh, I was noticing that bin is clear. Is that?
Yes, very good. Because I have always told people you must have a dark bin. And I decided to experiment. This was a very shallow box that I think you would store sweaters in or something, you know, and put it under your bed. Very shallow. So it was clear. It had a white lid. And I used it outside, and my worms were fine. In fact, they've done better in that bin than most of the bins I've ever used. So go figure, right? But yeah, so normally. And, you know, and maybe if it was deeper like this, it might be more of an issue. Because it is so shallow, the light, you know, this I kept in my carport, and, you know, the light coming in from the side didn't seem to bother them. Because they're hanging out here, they probably just didn't go to the side of the bin. But yeah, it worked for them. So, these are some of the things you would feed to earthworms. They love melon, love it, okay? Kind of their favorite, but coffee grounds and egg shells, not the eggs, and a variety of fruits and vegetables can be fed to the earthworms. These are the things you don't want to put in a worm bin, okay? Because if you have, you might want to put the light on again, but if you have meat and dairy products, when they're decomposing, they're very stinky, okay? So they just, you know, they're just kind of, they're rotting, they're stinky, and there's a chance that you could attract some unwanted visitors, especially if you have that beautiful coffee table worm bin in your living room, and your guests are sitting there, and this is, you know, scurrying across their feet. They might not appreciate that, so. If you are keeping dairy products and meat grease bones out of there, then you're not going to attract this, okay? The other thing is cat or dog feces, okay? A lot of people, they're conscious, they don't want to throw it away. You don't want to be putting this in your worm bin because you know it's got toxoplasmosis, right, and other pathogens that are harmful. So those are some things. And then worms tend to reject hot peppers and onions, real spicy things. Citrus fruits and rinds. Remember I talked about how if your worm bin is acidic, that can cause more problems? And so by putting citrus fruits or rinds in here, it can throw off the pH and attract red mites, and that's when you run into problems. So I never, ever put citrus in a worm bin this size. Super salty, we talked about that. If you put real sugary foods in there, it could attract ants, okay? So people who contact me and say, I've got ants coming to my worm bin, I ask, oh, did you put sugary stuff in there? Fruit pits, I added that to the list just because nothing will happen to them. I just toss them in the woods, you know? To break down over the next century. Fresh grass could heat up, and so you don't want to put fresh grass into the worm bin either. So, but storing the foods, you're not going to, wherever your worm bin is, whether it's in your living room or outside, you're not going to be eating an apple and then think, you know, oh, yeah, there was an ice storm, but I got to get to the worm bin, run out to the worm bin. That's not going to happen. It would be ridiculous to do that. So you're going to store your food scraps in a certain location, and then, you know, at your leisure, you're going to put them in the worm bin. So for me, it's maybe once a week, okay? So I used to keep my food scraps in a container you know, either on the kitchen counter or underneath, that's probably the number one spot. People put it in a container with a lid under their kitchen sink, okay? But what I think is even better is to just put it in your freezer. And because if you have your food scraps in a container sitting under your sink for a whole week, it's going to be decomposing. And when you open the lid, it's going to smell and it's going to be slimy, okay? And, you know, most of us are gardeners. It's like, oh, that doesn't bother me. It does bother some people, you know. You don't want that. And so if you put it in the freezer, it just suspends time. No decomposition is taking place. You leave it open. You don't have to have a lid. I just have an open bowl or an open, right now I think we have like an open plastic shoebox in the freezer. And that's where the food scraps, laundry lint, whatever, gets thrown in there. And then we take it out to the compost bin or the worm bin. Okay? So no smell. And then it also helps pre-digest the food because it changes the molecular structure. Food is mostly water. So it turns to ice. And then when it melts, you know, it decomposes much more quickly. So it's a cool way of storing your food scraps. So, food, just keep in mind not all food is alike. Again, the acidic food you don't want to put in there. Things that are high in moisture, it's fine to put in coffee grounds. But if you're a 10 cup a day person who constantly has, you know, you can overload with coffee grounds. They're moist, you don't want to develop a little lake in your worm bin. So just keep that in mind that canned, cooked, food and coffee grounds can be high in moisture. So I'm not saying don't put it in there, but put it in there realizing that you're adding extra moisture and it can cause problems in your bin. And then hardness, just keep in mind that you got broccoli and you got lettuce. Quite different on the hardness spectrum, right? So the broccoli is just going to take a lot longer to break down. So just keep it that in mind. And that's why it's so important to chop up food. And this is my favorite slide because this is one particle of food and the microorganisms can only deal with the outer surface of this particle of food. But if you chop it up, all of a sudden you have opened up the spaces in between. This is the same particle of food, but it's going to decompose much more quickly than this one. You see that? So that's my my little thing to chop up the food that you put in your worm bin. So to feed the earthworms, I always, if you were looking at the worm bin photo in my office, you might have noticed that I had a three-pronged garden tool sitting next to it. I always have this next to a worm bin because I don't really want to go through there with, not that I have fingernails, but you know, you just don't really want people clawing through a worm bin with their fingernails, and it's better just to pull it back with a three-pronged garden tool. Real easy to do, okay? So you got your bedding in there, and you're going to pull back the bedding with your tool, and you're going to put in the food waste, and then you're going to cover it. How important do I think covering is? I put it twice on the slide. This covering is the key to not having fruit flies. This is why, once again, knock on wood, I've never had fruit flies because I take my words seriously. Food waste, if you chop it up and you leave it on the counter and go entertain your guests, you come back, fruit flies. They've just shown up out of nowhere, right? That will happen with your worm bin if you have food just lying exposed. If you completely cover it, I mean seriously, so you don't see any food. It's completely covered. You don't want it on the bottom. Again, the worms are going up to eat, so you want it, you know, in the upper area of your worm bin, but you want to cover it with a couple of inches and make sure you can't see any food waste, and then you're not going to have a problem with fruit flies.
Okay, these are the traits of a healthy worm bin. And so when it's sitting there in your as your coffee table in your living room, you should not know that it's a worm bin. You should not smell anything. When you open the lid, it should smell like the forest. That's it. It'll smell like the earth. You should not see earthworms. You should only, the signs of a healthy worm bin, you can tell that your worms are happy, is that you won't really see them. And you'll see up to maybe six. If you see more than that, there's a problem. You need to pull out the troubleshooting guide on my website and find out what's wrong. Why am I seeing more than, say, six worms? Again, your food should not be visible. Your bedding should, again, we're not going to stir up our bedding, but there should be air spaces in the bedding, all right? The contents will be damp, but not soggy. The earthworms really should have moist, glistening skin. So if your earthworms look dry, that's another indicator that it's not moist enough in your worm bin. Your bedding will disappear over time. You'll see it, small quantities of other critters like we talked about. And the castings will accumulate on the bottom of the bin. They're always going down here. Okay, which brings us to, if they're down there, what do we do about getting them out, okay? So I'm gonna real quickly go over how to harvest worm bins. So if you have a worm bin like this one, and you've got castings on the bottom, how are you gonna get them out? And you're gonna harvest them either once or twice a year, depending on how much you're into it or how much you're creating. Could be three times a year. Some people only do it once a year. So I am not getting into something where you gotta be out there doing something daily, okay? These are actually pictures from Gina's house, Gina Myers. This is what they did. They chose a nice sunny day. They put out a tarp and they dumped out their worm bin into piles. And the worms will move away from the light. They'll move down into the pile. And so you're removing the castings, putting them into a container labeled black gold. And then you're setting up your worm bin with more bedding. And then any old bedding and any worms that you come across, they'll go back in the bin. Okay? It's a pretty simple process. It takes about an hour, hour and a half to do that. Okay? Outside on a sunny day or inside under light. So the worms will move away. The next we call sideways separation. This takes about 6 weeks to happen, and so you plan ahead for this, and what you do is you mentally divide your bin in half, just like the photo shows there. You can see, everybody can see the photo. Mm-hmm. And so what we've done is, this is the side that we've decided to feed. So we're putting, so we start out with the whole bin, okay? And then when we decide that it's time to harvest the bin a few weeks ahead of time, we start feeding only on one side. The worms will move over here eventually. It's not like cats and dogs who say, oh, the food's over there. They'll eventually move over there after a few weeks. And so then you'll be left with mostly castings that you would remove and put in your black gold container. And then you put your bedding over here and entice the worms to move over here, okay? So that's why it takes about 6 weeks, because it takes a few weeks for them to move from side to side. The other is called vertical separation. That's where I showed you that I had extra holes. I didn't bring the extra bin, but the other bin looks identically like this. What you would do in this case with the $5 bin, so we've got the two $5 bins versus the $100 bin, okay? So you would start to only vermicompost in this bin. This one gets set aside, okay? You ignore that bin. You've got a lid on this bin. This one builds up after a few months, 3-4 months or so. The castings and bedding have moved up to about here. So you put the other bin in on top of it that has plenty of holes in it, and you start only feeding in that bin. The worms will move up into that bin. So you're completely ignoring this bin. You forget about this one. Some of the worms will stay down there and say, oh good, I have more elbow room. The worms have left. But eventually, most of them will move into this bin because it's got the fresh food. And so after a while, maybe a month or so, you can remove this bin and empty out the castings. And you just start the process over again. This is a similar process where you start out with one tray and then eventually you add another tray. I have two different styles of this bin in my worm barn right now. So now we're going to talk about the black gold and why I call it that. Okay, so these are the properties of vermicompost. It's fully stabilized. So when you're composting, regular thermophilic composting, the temperature goes up and then the temperature has to come down. And it doesn't just come down and stay down. It goes up again and it kind of fluctuates for a while. And that's why we cure it for a few months, so that it stabilizes. Because otherwise, it can burn our plants, right? We've heard about compost burning plants. Well, with vermicomposting, it's a totally different thing. So the organic materials are being ingested by the worms. They're passing through an animal and coming out the other side, and it's stable. So you can take vermicompost and put it directly on plants, and it won't burn the plants. It's more microbially active than the parent material, as you saw from my crude drawing, right? Fine particulate structure, because it came out of the end of a worm, right? It's tiny. The pH is near neutral. It's got lots of macro and micronutrients, depending on what has been fed to the worms. The feedstock, of course, would affect what comes out the other end. And then they have plant growth hormones and humic and fulvic acids that will help the plants grow healthier and stronger. So you can use vermicompost in gardens, lawns, around trees, you know, your potted plants, farm fields, nurseries, golf courses. Everybody uses vermicompost. Like compost, it has similar properties where it helps the soil by improving the structure. It makes the soil, increases the moisture infiltration, and then it actually holds the moisture in the soil. So it just has all sorts of great properties for soil. And then what it does with plants is amazing. It will increase the germination rate. So seeds will germinate more quickly. They'll grow better root systems, taller, stronger, a better structure to the stem of the plant, and then you'll have higher yields as well of whatever that plant produces. And then it also decreases attacks by plant pathogens, parasitic nematodes, and insects. Can everybody see all the way down to the...
Good.
Okay. All right. Remember I talked about the value and I said your eyes were going to pop out? A cubic yard of compost, okay, cubic yard, 3 feet by 3 feet by 3 feet, right? It sells, if you're producing compost, you'll sell it for up to $30 per cubic yard. If you're selling vermicompost, you will sell it for a minimum of $400 per cubic yard. Same amount. $400 minimum. I've seen it sold in bags for up to $1,800 per cubic yard. Because people don't do the math. They don't know the math to do with it. But I do. So anyway, big difference in value. So remember the plant growth?
So this was a couple of colleagues and I over at Bio and Ag Engineering. We had a grant where we were studying water quality, the effect of vermicompost on water quality. So we were not studying plant growth, but we were like, wow, we should take a picture of this. So, but we had field trials over the spring and fall in different fields, actually, with randomized plots where all of the plots had the same amount of nitrogen, equal nitrogen, whether it had 0 or 10% or 20% by volume vermicompost. Everybody had the same nitrogen. But this is what happened. So, zero vermicompost. This is a regular sized turnip with, look at its root. This is 10% by volume vermicompost. You're in the turnip business, you just hit the jackpot. The turnip green business, you know? Look at those roots. This is 20% by volume. That's it. Small amount. People say, well, if you had done 100% vermicompost with the, you know, seeing this, you'd think that 100% vermicompost, the turnip would be as big as this room, right? But the way it works is that it actually becomes too much. So once you get up to 50% by volume, then it actually starts going down and looking more like this again. It's too much for the plant. So very interesting. And especially if you're paying so much for vermicompost, you want to use a small amount. So the beauty is that you only need to.
What kind of soil was the other 80 or 90%? Was this just good?
This was in the field. So these were fields just south of here. And so it was just whatever, you know, and this took place about 15 years ago. And so, but it was whatever the local fields are here. So it's not like it was metro mix or anything like that. It was just straight field soil. But we tested the soil to see how much nitrogen it had. We tested how much was in the vermicompost. We made sure it was equal amounts. And it's because it's not, you know, everybody thinks, oh, plant growth, NPK, those are the big factors. But for vermicompost, the nitrogen will not knock your socks off. Sometimes it will, but usually it won't. It's the plant growth hormones and the fulvic acids that is doing the plant growth stuff and the microorganisms. So, for example, this is pythium. Pythium is a very common plant disease, and this work was done at Ohio State University, and they were using cucumber seedlings. And so there was the control with no vermicompost, and it had a very high amount of pythium. And they took sterilized vermicompost, okay? When you sterilize vermicompost, you're killing the microorganisms, right? Most of them will disappear. So sterilized vermicompost still had a lot of pythium in it. Then they took straight unsterilized vermicompost, bye-bye pythium. Look at that. 10% by volume vermicompost, same amount as 40% by volume vermicompost. So again, you're gonna do the math on that and go, I think I'll choose 10%. But look at that. And so this particular professor, Norman Irikon, he was at Ohio State, now he's at University of Hawaii, Hilo. He speaks at my vermiculture conference every year, and he has, you know, a multitude of slides like this. I just, you know, borrowed a couple of his just to show, but he's done so many plant diseases on a variety of plants. So, you know, cucumbers and tomatoes and, you know, on and on and on. One other slide I got from him to show pest suppression. They put these pepper plants inside glass chambers and introduced mealybugs, okay? So about 65-68 mealybugs were put into a chamber, and then they had to count all the bugs on the plants. And so the control had, you know, covered with mealybugs. 20% by volume vermicompost was the medium. Metro 360 was the other soil. But anyway, The mealybugs were not landing on the plants. And then this is 40% by volume. So, and again, I only wanted to take a couple of his slides, but, you know, pretty dramatic results, right? I just wanted to show you that there are application rates, you know, but you kind of got the message that if you're adding 10 or 20% vermicompost, you can't go wrong with that, okay? You can go wrong with getting over-enthusiastic, and I do. I'm guilty of that. I'm like, oh, vermicompost is so good that I forget that a little bit goes a long way, and I add too much, so don't be guilty of that. If you do have liquid coming out of the bottom, like I said, you should not. But if there is dark liquid coming out of the bottom of your bin, unlike what it says on the internet, it's not worm tea that's good for your plants, okay? You will see plant growth from using it, but I'm telling you, as an extension specialist, it's not a good thing to use. I call it the stinky mystery liquid. It's mystery. What is it? It's passed through undigested stuff. So we don't know the nutrient levels. We don't know the pathogen levels in it. It stinks, so we know it's got anaerobic bacteria. I don't think any of those things are good for plants, especially, you know, food crops, prized roses. So I put it on my weeds. Just saying. So making, just to show you that it is being done on a large scale, that's why the people are coming to me from around the world to learn about vermicomposting. So this is horse manure just east of here in Mebane. So very simple. These are some guys in Durham that attended my worm conference, and they have these barrels in their basement. And they're selling, it's new soil. If any of you have seen them at the farmer's market, they're expanding. This is when I was in Chile. This was also in Chile. This is the horizontal method where they're feeding here. And then when they want the worms to move over, they start feeding here. And then they start feeding here. And so it goes all the way around. We made it into a very lovely outdoor worm bin. This is another picture from Chile, where they were very successfully with, you know, just 2x4s and sticks. They made their worm bins for outdoors. This is when I was in the Dominican Republic. And so just to show that, you know, just having this on the ground is a way to contain your worms. I told them, well, what I think you should do is take these concrete blocks and concentrate on growing here. They were trying to do everything at once with hardly any worms. So I'm like, okay. And then you can open this up and move them down. So that's the beauty. It makes it into an expanding system. This is in Michigan. They have an outdoor worm bin. The worms died one winter. So the community came together and said, we're going to build you a solar unit for your worm bin. So they're very happy there in Michigan. This is in South Carolina at a prison that I visited. This is hog manure. This used to take place in North Carolina. The guy who created this system is now over 80 years old, and so he's not operating it anymore. But it's, you know, a tractor would drive down the 200-foot worm bin and straddle the worm beds. So there were five of these in here, and he had a manure spreader on the back that was calibrated to drop about an inch of hog manure on top of the worm beds, and so that's how he fed the worm beds, the worms. This is a huge operation in upstate New York. It's probably the largest in this hemisphere of indoor vermicomposting. It was featured on the History Channel's Modern Marvels series. So, and this is all the rage. This is in a restaurant and ale house in Idaho, and this is in their basement. So they shred up their weekly menus, and
and they have worms, and their food waste go in coffee grounds, go into the worm bin in the basement. So I have there's a book, there's only one scientific book on vermicomposting, and I co-edited it along with Norman Aircon, you know, the guy who's in Hawaii. And so anyway, we've got contributing authors from 13 countries, it's 600 pages, it's a whole lot, but anyway, just to let you know it's there. And then I hold the only training on mid to large scale vermicomposting that I know of in the world. And so I'm about to offer my 17th one. It'll be this fall at the Hunt Library, hopefully. We haven't nailed it down yet, but hopefully at here on campus. But anyhow, you can go to the URL and check it out, you know, check out what happened last year. But the guy from, the professor from Hawaii will definitely be speaking. This is my compost training facility as it looks now. You can see my big 40 by 30 foot worm barn, where my worms are, you know, well, they're happier today, right? They were very unhappy last weekend. They're a little happier today. But anyhow, so this is what it looks like. But we've got some design students working on a new design, and it's going to really be beautiful. And lots going on out there, lots of ways. I'd love to have the master gardeners volunteer out there, get your hands dirty. We're going to have plant growth studies going on, so you can see the, or demonstrations, so you can see the difference between, you know, no vermicompost, and this is using compost, this is using vermicompost. Lots of possibilities out there. So, like I said, I've got my own URL, so worms.ncsu.edu. And so why don't we turn on the lights, and you may have questions. He has a question right away.
You had a slide up there on compost tea, but you have skipped over it. You want?
Oh, sure. Yeah, that would just tell about how to make it. That there are ways, you know, some people will do it. There's non-aerated, and then there's aerated. And so you can do it either way, but, you know, most studies show that aerated works better. But I have a simple directions. If you wanted to email me, I can send you simple directions for how to make compost tea in like a 5 gallon bucket. You don't have to go out. I do, at my compost training facility, I have a really nice tea brewer that's commercially made, you know, but you can make it yourself.
Well, there's, I think there's some disagreement on how much disease suppression you can get from spraying.
Right, there is. It's still, that's why I don't really like talking about it, because that's just it. And with all studies, you know, I mean, it's interesting when you think about all the, I mean, you can't just say tomato plants. How many species of tomato plants are there, you know? And then when a study's done, it's just done with one type of vermicompost tea. It might not be very good vermicompost. The thing about Norman Aircon, and I said he has all these slides, he shows four different types of vermicompost. So vermicompost made from hog manure, from dairy manure, from food waste, and from paper waste. And you can see the different effects that those had on different species of plants. So it's all very complicated. And so not enough studies have been done using compost tea, but I can tell you, probably the compost or the vermicompost that was used was not very good anyway. So, anyway, lots, yeah, that's a whole other lecture on tea.
How much do you get out of a typical family household?
That's just it. What is a typical family household? Because it could be a couple, or for you, typical might be you and your six kids.
How about you and your household?
Oh, in my household, well, nowadays my household is mostly one. yeah, kids have grown. So it really depends. It really depends. It depends on how much people eat. I had a rich woman. It was obvious she was really rich from what she was telling me over the phone. That she eats out all the time. And so she only was putting orange peels and banana peels in there, which was not, so it was spelling disaster for her, you know. So it's hard to say, you know, especially if you're raising your own food, you might have more produce. If you're vegetarian, you might have more produce, or paleo diet, you know, whatever.
Is there a pound ratio that you would think, like 10 pounds in equals 1 pound out?
Oh, okay, what you put in, okay, good way of putting it, yes. Again, it depends on what you put in. He asked how much you put in, how much comes out, and it really depends on what you're feeding them. Food waste, it's mostly water, it tends to disappear very quickly, so you may get, usually it's, well, so it varies, that what you get out will be anywhere from 25 to 70% of what you put in. So it really varies, but, you know, so 50% is a thumbnail, you know, you can say on average maybe 50% of what you put in.
But you would not feed it every day.
No, and that's why I was saying I do it every week.
A lot of compost, I mean, vegetables, salads, you know, whatever.
Well,
I couldn't put it in there every day.
Yes, and because the problem is they're not going to keep up with it, you know. That's why I insist that you start with at least a pound of worms, because people, they see the price tag and they go, oh, you know, forget that. I'll get three more neighbors to come in and I'll only put a quarter pound of worms. And then they think they can just fill it up with their family's food. And a quarter pound of worms is not going to eat very much. So that's why I always have a backyard bin going, always. So that I put, you know, obviously $400 per cubic yard versus 30, right? Mm-hmm. The worm bin's more valuable. So I'm pickier about what I put in my worm bin. And then I put my orange slices and everything goes into the outdoor composter. You know, that's more forgiving. It's a bigger environment and you can kind of put whatever in there. But for the worm bin, I'm careful to not overfeed. Yep.
What I'm thinking about trying to do a backyard trench. So uh-huh. That I don't have to baby it so much.
Uh-huh.
Thinking about, you know, I can just put more stuff in there. Is that a reasonable way to think about, like with the cinder blocks around it so that it's a bigger area?
You could do it.
Put more stuff in it.
Yeah. A trench worm bin or a trench?
A trench worm bin.
Oh, yeah. I'm planning to do that at my worm farm. The compost training facility. Yeah, we should put our heads together about that because, yeah, just to have a bigger area. And it is more forgiving when you have a big area. It's a big difference to have a worm bin like this and to have a larger worm bin. It makes a big difference.
I have one of the black plastic regular compost bins I got from the city.
Yes.
Which never worked properly for me because I'm too short to be able to turn it.
Okay.
And it just so it didn't get turned and so it didn't work. But somebody said he was doing he had worms in one of those bins outdoors.
Mm-hmm.
And my question about that would be one about the temperatures, low temperatures. Is there something you need to do to keep make sure it didn't get too cold? But also could it be too deep?
Yes.
So,
yes, it can.
Because the activity is really just in the top.
Yes.
So.
Yeah, and that's why you want a worm bin about this deep. Mm-hmm. Because the purpose of the bigger compost bins is that you need to have a certain mass.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know if you got an earth machine from the city, maybe?
This was probably 15 years ago.
Okay,
because
it might be. And it's a good worm bin, but ideally you would have 4 feet by 4 feet by 4 feet for an outdoor compost bin to allow it to heat up and then hold that heat. It needs that much mass. That's why you never ever want that for a worm bin, because that has a chance of overheating. You'll notice I said don't put fresh grass in here. It could heat up. You don't want materials to heat up inside this worm bin. So you want to keep it shallow.
Yes. I have one of the backyard bins. It's probably about 30 gallons.
Mm-hmm.
And, of course, it never heats up because you're just adding stuff to it. Well, I say it doesn't heat up. Occasionally it gets warm enough that the worms will actually come up and accumulate on the lid. And that's why I said I'm accidentally vermicomposting unintentionally. But the question was, when I use that compost, a lot of times I'll have excessive tomato seedlings and some other things because it never gets hot. In vermicomposting, do you get seed viable seeds?
Yes, you do. You do. Definitely. Yes. Because it doesn't fill it. It's not hot in there, so the seeds will sprout. So if you were doing production vermicompost, like the big ones, the commercial people I showed you, they would pre-compost, so they're killing seeds, okay? They would kill seeds and pathogens so that that wouldn't happen.
So you can use partially composted materials to feed them?
Well, I said they're reaching the temperatures that will kill. So they're reaching temperatures over 140 degrees.
What I mean. If you had composted
right. So if you had composted successfully and gone over 140 degrees, then your seeds would likely be killed, and you could put them in your vermicompost, and they would not sprout. But otherwise, anything that has seeds that goes in Rhonda has the ability to sprout.
But it would still have food value for the worms, I guess, if you had that compost.
Yes, compost does have food value for worms, yes. That's why we call it pre-composting, because you don't, for bedding, it's fine to have finished compost, but for feed for the worms, you want to have what we call pre-compost. And it means it's reached those high temperatures long enough to kill pathogens and kill weed seeds, and then we've taken it out of the compost bin. We don't let it finish composting. We let it cool down enough to feed to the worms, and then you don't have to worry about pathogens or weed seeds. Because, you know, if you're selling a vermicompost product, you don't want to have that happening.
Well, I was thinking it's time to start seedlings, and I'm ready to go out and buy something to mix with my potting mix.
Uh-huh. You're ready to buy vermicompost?
Yes.
I'm
encouraged by it.
Good. Yeah, just keeping in mind that not all growers are alike, you know. The composting world, okay, so you've got thermophilic composters and you have vermicomposters, okay? And I'm president of the North Carolina Composting Council, so, you know, I work with a lot of commercial composters, and most of them who are, well, they're all regulated. If they have a large-scale facility, then they have to get a permit from the state to be making and selling vermicompost, but not all of them do, and some of them still don't do things correctly, and so there's something called the STA program. It's part of the U.S. Composting Council, where they've developed standards, and they have standardized testing labs where composting facilities will pay a fee to them to get their product tested, and then it gets, you know, the certification, so you can be confident that it's a good product, you know. Unfortunately, for vermicompost, there are no regulations for vermicompost, and so you really have to just kind of, that's why I hold the worm conference, you know. I've got people, I teach them the importance of their product, producing a really good product, and then I know some people in the business who take it very seriously. Worm Power that I showed you, they have had innumerable grants with Cornell University testing their vermicompost. And so it's a really good product.
Are there any local sources you can work with?
No. there's kind of a dearth of, well, I mean, new soil in Durham, you know, they attended my conference. They take it very seriously. And they're in the process of expanding. So, like I said, they've been selling vermicompost and worms at Durham farmers markets, two of them, for the past couple of years. Now they're expanding. So I don't know if they're even selling anything right now just because they're in the process of expanding. But new soil in Durham, I know they're doing things correctly.
Is that N-E-W or N-U?
N-E-W, yes.
there are some people in the mountains who are making vermicompost. So, and, you know, locally, I don't necessarily know what's being sold. You can always contact me and ask me if I'm, you know, familiar with whoever you're looking at buying.
Are any of the breweries doing this whole cycle?
Breweries. Some are doing composting or vermicomposting. In fact, there's somebody communicating with me in Colorado. Some people will use brewery.
Seems like it would be a good source.
It can be. It can be high in ammonia. It really depends on whatever grains are being used and I think the process. And so some brewery distilled grains do well with vermicomposting and some are not appropriate. So the best way, so it's really important that whenever you feed worms, you know, if you're just going to give them your kitchen scraps, it's going to be okay. But say if you wanted to, you had a farm or something, and you wanted to, you were wondering about a feedstock, what you can do is just take a small number of worms in a small container and introduce that feedstock, and they'll either run away from it, crawl away, or they'll dig in and start eating it. So it's important to test that before you, you know, buy your pound of worms or more and then have them die. You really don't want that to happen. And that's why I encourage you to go to the website where there's just a lot more information. I know for me it helps to, you know, read things over too. And that's why I was saying worms can recycle your garbage has lots of details. But on the website it'll say four households. And so that's about this kind of vermicomposting. They'll say four schools, and that's how schools, it's got my curriculum in it and, you know, other resources for schools. And then another tab says for businesses, farms, municipalities, and institutions, and that has a whole lot of resources because that's where the biggest popularity of my program has been, you know, I mean, because you can learn about small-scale vermicomposting throughout the country. But large scale is, you know, it's harder to find information.
I mentioned anybody interested in coffee grounds, Starbucks packages, there's that.
Right, they do. Yeah, Starbucks will give it away. Some
just,
of them
just can't use too much.
Right, and I said that because there was a an office. You know, as you can imagine, an office, lots of people are drinking coffee, and they had a worm bin for the office in their break room. And, you know, probably one person was not really paying, you know, in charge of the worms. And everybody was dumping the coffee grounds in there. And pretty soon, it's, you know, a pool in there. You know, it was just like this stinking mess. And it's because they didn't realize. So I always caution. I just, you know, I'm giving you, like, too much information. I try to cover it all to keep you from getting into trouble. You know, because if, on the other hand, it's very forgiving, you know, but like I said, you know, my worms, they have no heat, I just put some insulation around them and set it drying around when it was 20 degrees less,
could
you know, for days on end, so.
Could you keep them in the crawl space?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Hotter cold.
Because my worm barn, you know, it's got open ends, so. This is it right here. So this whole side is open. The other end has a big opening. And then under the eaves, you can see right there, the walls don't go all the way up. So it's just as cold in there as it is outside. And so, you know, it's like being outdoors.
So you did put insulation. You did something.
Yeah.
What was that like?
Yeah, so I feel like I didn't do the best job that I could. Actually, well, and part of the problem is our fluctuating temperatures. So this past weekend, I actually worried about them being too warm. I'm always worrying about my worms. But did I feel motivated to go out there and help them? No, I didn't. But anyway, because I think they were fine. But, you know, that's just it. Now, like, you know, it's a pretty decent temperature today, but then it'll go little cooler than what they would like tonight, so that's why I'm not going to just take all the insulation away. So I actually wrapped bubble wrap around this type of bin, you know,
just because that's all I had, and you know, I just thought it might give some insulating qualities. I think I was deluding myself, but anyway, I ended up kind of stacking them all together and putting 3-inch thick foam board, you know, insulation board around the bin they were in. There are produce crates you can get that are about 40 inches by 40 inches, and they have holes all over so that the produce gets aerated. And I looked at it and said, worm bin, you know? And so I have 3 of them at my site. And so one of them has worms in it. So it's a nice big space of worms over a cubic foot of, you know, I put over 10 pounds of worms in there. And then I have 5 other smaller bins, and those were the ones I was worried about. So we kind of crowded all of those together in another of the big produce crates and put the insulation around it. I was desperate to do something. So don't want to lose my worms.
Rhonda, have many studies on the benefits of it and how much to use in soil for plants. I've gotten interested in growing vegetables in pots for people that don't have gardens. Rule of thumb is how much you use for how much potting soil.
Yeah, that's that. I have that slide, kind of went over it very quickly. You know, it's a volume thing, so like I said, if you're going with 10 or 20% volume, up to 25%, this is the one. So, like 2 tablespoons per quart potting mix every 2 to 4 weeks. Is one thing, you know, I've just seen that on the sites, or 1 part to 4 parts potting media. So that's basically what you're doing. Again, you just don't want to put too much in there. That's a really good way to go, and your plants just get, you can tell the difference.
Looks like the questions, Rhonda. Thank you for a great job.
Thank you.